A quorum being present, this town meeting is called to order. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. All right, here's how we will probably proceed tonight. We're going to open with the second special town meeting, the one dealing with liquor licenses. When we finish that, we'll move into the first special town meeting, originally scheduled for last Monday. I expect that will be adjourned to another night. Under Article 1 of that town meeting, I'll ask for a brief report giving the body the status of the subject matter and the reasons for the delay and when they would like it delayed to. Next, we'll adjourn that meeting and reconvene the subsequent town meeting, the regularly scheduled November session. We have 5 articles left. Maybe we can finish. A bit of trivia, I'm pretty sure tonight marks the first time in the town's 372-year history that we've had 3 separate meetings operating in one night. Now, is there any business under Article 1? Mr. Halsey moves that we lay Article 1 on the table. Is there a second? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, the motion carries. Business under Article 2. Mr. Halsey moves that we lay Article 2 on the table. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, the motion carries. Business under Article 3. Mr. Halsey moves that we lay Article 3 on the table. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, the motion carries. Business under Article 4. Mr. LaLasher.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Just for town meeting members' advice, there is a handout for tonight. It's 1 page, both sides, that have the motions. First 3 don't count, but the last one is important. And there is a friendly amendment to what's in the written material by town council that I'll get to. I'm going to give a brief 5 or 10 minute discussion of the background and the reasons we're here. And I think by the time I'm done, you'll understand. I'm going to go through the 3 sections specifically of the home rule petition. When town council first wrote it, I said, are you kidding? Can you put it in English? So I had a really hard time getting through it, but after looking at some of the Mass General laws and talking to town council, I think I understand it now. Under Mass General Law, Chapter 138, Section 11, that requires that 4 questions are placed on a local ballot every 2 years, the even number years in November, in order to have liquor licenses. Those 4 questions are listed behind me. I won't read them in entirely, but one is for all alcohol licenses. One is for beer and wine licenses, and those are both restaurants and other things. And then the second one is package stores. I think I finally found out how package store word got invented, alcoholic beverages in packages. And this goes back to the 60s. And then the last one is as a hotel. So these are the 4 questions that would typically, in order for a town or a city to adopt alcohol, this is how they would do it, typically. And in Section 1 of what's in front of you, we don't want to do it that way specifically. But to go back to those 4 questions, an affirmative vote on any of those questions authorizes a town to issue a license for 2 years until the next election. Once the town has voted in 3 consecutive elections, either up or down, that is considered the final vote. And until the town petitions the Secretary of State, that is the final word on liquor licenses. The Secretary of State automatically places these on the ballot, or so to speak, and the only way to then, after 3 consecutive votes, come back is to have a citizen's petition or a special act. In 1970, which challenges even Mr. Brown's memory, town meeting voted against both questions A and B. To our knowledge, the Secretary did not place these on the ballot again, which they should have. They should have appeared 3 consecutive elections. There is evidence that the town voted positively for question C in elections 1970 and 72, but not in a 3rd election. We have no evidence that it voted a 3rd time. Again, typically the Secretary of State would insist that these questions are on the ballot, so we're just not really sure why. That process would typically take, again, 3 elections, 6 years. We had that option now. That seems too long. So we want to bypass the 6-year process and go to another process of special act. We want to grant liquor licenses under these three sections of Mass General Law, 12, 15, and 14. I'm going to mostly discuss 12 and 15 shortly. Just to take a step back, so you know where we are now, what Town Council learned was, Houston, we have a problem. We don't know if we have any liquor licenses that are valid based on the research we did. In order to really make that full determination, we turned up Town Hall inside out. We would have to go to the state and ask. And we met with the chair of the selectmen, and it was determined that the most important single thing that we could do is protect our existing liquor license holders, period. They have the liquor licenses in good faith. They've running businesses on it. And that was clearly the priority, as long as we could do it lawfully. So the special act method is the best way to do it, since we didn't feel like asking the state, can you find the paperwork that we can't find? Section 17 establishes quotas for alcohol licenses under both sections 12 and 15. You can see by the little chart at the bottom of the page that we use 3/4 of these. We have all alcohol licenses under sections 12 and 15, and again, 15 is package stores, 12 is all others, primarily restaurants and clubs. And we have wine and beer under section 12. But for those of you that were in annual town meeting back in 2005, by a very strong majority, town meeting turned down beer and wine licenses for package stores. You can see that behind me. Notwithstanding that vote that was just up behind me, the ABCC believes the town has 5 available beer and wine licenses for package stores. We don't know why. So section one of this act basically explains what we don't want to follow. And section two explains and codifies that the current policy I just showed you, 3 of those 4 boxes are what we want, and we don't want the thing that ABCC thinks we have. Just to be clear, this special act is not seeking any change from what we believe the status quo is. If the community, through the Board of Selectmen and ultimately town meeting, wants to make a change to that status quo, that option is still available. We just would do it either through the 6-year cycle on a ballot or through a special act. Section 3 is just being extremely careful to make sure that all our existing liquor license holders are protected. So I'm going to show you who those are. Under the on-premises licenses, the section 12, we have 20 licenses issued. I believe we have 7 that are not issued that the town has available. 18 are all alcohol, 2 are beer and wine, 14 of those 18 are restaurants, and again, I'll show you the list. For package stores, we have 6 issued. 5 of those are default by the size of our population. One of those is a real alcohol license that we know is right, because we did that by a special act for Pamplemousse. But the other 5, again, there's some uncertainty in our minds, which is why we have this special act. So just to follow up with a list of who the customers are here, we have 14 restaurants, this is very up to date, that have all alcohol licenses. And again, there's 7 additional licenses not yet used. This category is rounded out by the 4 clubs, and then 2 beer and wine only licenses, one for Bangkok Spice as a restaurant, one for Paint and Sip, the Art Lounge on Haven Street, general on premise. So there is all your section 12, 20 licenses. And then section 15 package stores, there's the 6 package stores we have, and again, Pamplemousse achieved or acquired a liquor license by special act. The other 5 should have achieved it through the 1970s votes. And again, to be really clear, even though the ABCC believes otherwise, we do not have and we have not issued a beer and wine package store license. So that's the situation in a nutshell. We decided it was not prudent to go poking around and asking the state a lot of questions. We looked for all the paperwork we had. We decided the most prudent thing was expeditiously to fix what we thought was a problem. And a special act will accomplish that. It will protect all the licenses that we've given out in good faith, understanding what we thought the rules were. This will allow the ABCC, when they go to their online system, possibly as early as the spring, almost for sure by next fall at the latest, to understand that they can't give out licenses that we don't think we have. And that's the only reason we really uncovered this situation, is my executive secretary was looking at the online equipment, online system that the ABCC was testing. She was helping them beta test. And she asked them, why do you show five licenses we don't have? Because she's been telling people we don't have them for over 20 years, so she knows better than anyone. And the ABCC had no idea. They just said, well, it's in the database. You have five of those, so you can give them out. And if we did nothing, there would be people that would apply online directly for these, in good faith, could spend money and believe they have a license, and then come to find out the town says it doesn't. So, you know, that's one of the wonders of technology. So we thought, and town council advised, that a special act would clear this up quickly. We only uncovered this problem in September, October. And this is the fastest way to take care of it. The six-year process was just not satisfactory. Again, to the extent that the town wishes to change any alcohol policy in the future, that's not hard to do. It'll come to this body as it always would. And it'll probably most reasonably come in the form of another special act. It is more typical that towns do not take the special act, but they do this in the 1970s. Doing a special act is not uncommon these days, but it's a little bit uncommon to adopt all of your alcohol licenses this way, because cities and towns would have done this 40 years ago.
Is there further discussion? None appearing. Are we ready for the vote? This only requires a majority vote, but we traditionally take a standing count when we are submitting to the state. So do I have the four counters from the previous night? Bill, Steve, Phil, and yes. Okay, all those in favor, please rise. Thirty-two.
26.
26.
Forty-five.
And those opposed?
Zero.
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 Zero. Zero. And who was the fourth one? Zero. Vote being 129 in the affirmative, zero in the negative, the motion carries. Do we have a motion to adjourn? Sine die. Mr. Halsey moves that we adjourn the special town meeting. Sine die. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. This town meeting stands adjourned. Sine die.
Thank you.
We now open the special town meeting number one, which deals with litigation. Do we have a report, Mr. LaLasher?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. The school committee would request that this special town meeting be postponed to Thursday, December 8th. There's been a lot of discussion around litigation, including an executive session meeting tonight at 6:30. We are 99.5% of the way there. We don't believe that that's an adequate number to bring an agreement to town meeting and say, trust us on the last 0.5. So the objective of the school committee is to bring a fully executed signed version of an agreement to this body to approve. And with the holiday, we didn't think having it early next week really would work. But Thursday, December 8th should be a foolproof way of bringing this body full information, full transparency, and letting you decide.
Mr. Mann?
If I could just ask a question, Jamie Maughan, Precinct 4. When you say fully signed by whom?
I believe that would be signed by the school committee and then the counterpart on the other side, outside of the town.
On the other side, you mean the contractor?
That's a complicated question. There's a bond company, there's a contractor that's bankrupt, there's lawyers. Somebody will sign it on the other side, maybe more than one.
So even though it's a signed agreement by both parties, it's not in effect until it's approved by town meeting. Is that correct?
It's not funded until town meeting approves the funding is probably the better way to say it.
What happens with that signed agreement if town meeting doesn't approve it?
It goes away.
Thank you.
Okay, we have a motion by Mr. Halsey to adjourn this town meeting until Thursday, December 8th. Is that what you said?
At 7:30.
At 7:30. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, motion carries. The town meeting number one is adjourned until Thursday, December 8th. We now call the subsequent meeting to order, and we're looking for business under, where are we? Article 27. Mr. Savina.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Article 27 deals with a special home occupation. So what we've done here is we've created a new category of home occupation called special home occupation. And it provides the ability to have one additional employee in a home-based business, whether that employee does or does not reside in the residence. It allows special home occupation as an accessory use to the residential use through a special permit processed by CPDC. And that allows us to take into consideration what the use is and its impact on the neighborhood. We could put a time limit on the special permit, say a year, and then review it again if there were issues with that.
Are you all set?
Yep.
Oh, I'm sorry. Do you have a CPDC report?
On Monday, July 11th, 2016, CPDC convened to hold a public hearing on proposed Article 27. All documents were available on the town website. A public hearing was held to provide an opportunity for comment and to determine whether the provisions of the proposed zoning bylaw shall be adopted by the town. The July 11th, 2016 public hearing was opened at approximately 8:30 p.m. Any comments received at the hearing were included as part of the record of the hearing. Public hearing was continued to Monday, August 8th, 2016 at 8:30 p.m. to allow time for future discussion and public input. On August 8th, 2016, the hearing was closed. The CPDC voted 3-0-0 to recommend Article 27 to town meeting.
Thank you. Is there further discussion? Yes, Ms. Binda.
Angela Binda, Precinct 5. So this would allow an additional person to be working with the primary person working. Does that mean that the current bylaw home occupation by right does not allow anyone to be working with the person?
The way I understand it, the current home occupation bylaw allows anyone who's residing at the property to work in that home occupation, but not someone who does not reside there.
So, if you're a hairdresser and you have somebody come in one day a week to help you, or you're an accountant and you have somebody come in, is that not allowed at this time? Do people know that?
No.
Okay. So I'm wondering what's going to happen to all of those people who have businesses out of their home who might not know, because when I read it says a residential person has to, obviously the person who lives there is the business, but I would never have thought, I thought that if they had an assistant, that would be allowed. So what happens to all those people who currently might have an employee?
Sure. I mean, this gives us a mechanism to deal with it if it becomes a problem. I'm not sure what enforcement would be right now.
That's a good question, Angela. So right now, If someone came in and asked us about it, that's how we would find out. Or if someone called us, we would find out about it. Or if they came in to get a business certificate from the town clerk, we would find out. Otherwise, we really don't have a mechanism.
So I guess you're making a new rule to allow for it, but my guess is that this is probably existing in a lot of places, and it might be that they might even have more than one employee working for them. And I don't know anywhere that, are you allowing two employees to be working? I mean, even if it's not two employees every day working there, there might be under certain circumstances, if you have a home business, where you might have more than one employee that comes in once a week, or for a short period of time. So I don't know what, I think this is creating some problems, and I don't know. I'm not quite sure what this is solving. I'm seeing that it's a mechanism to allow it. I don't know who would come forward and actually ask for it. If you were already doing it, I'd be afraid to come forward and say, oh, guess what? I have two employees. Never knew I couldn't do that.
Right. We're not really so concerned necessarily about the people who are already doing it. What we're concerned about is the people that come in for a business certificate. They come down to the public services office to find out if their home-based business is allowed by zoning. Someone like a tax preparer who wants to have one assistant, we have to say no. And I mean, that just seems a little bit, it's a difficult thing to do.
See, what's happening is that it may be going on everywhere, but somebody new who's going through the process the right way comes to the counter and is told, no, you can't have that. So while, you know, we won't worry about enforcing it necessarily unless it becomes a problem, I think, somewhere else, at least this gives us a mechanism to help those people who are coming forward to go through the process the correct way.
And did you think of allowing more than one employee? Because I would think that there probably are people, you know, on a temporary basis who have more than one employee. So again, you're only allowing one employee, so there's still...
This zoning bylaw amendment is not to make a residential property look like anything different than a residential property. So we wanted to be careful about the number of employees that we didn't really consider more than one. That's an honest answer. But we wanted to be careful about changing the nature of these neighborhoods.
And I understand that, but again, like a lot of home businesses are the kind of the type that on a temporary basis during tax season or during Christmas, if you're doing whatever seasonal work you're doing, you might have a few other people. So is there a way to grandfather people in who already are existing so that there might not be any repercussions, you know, should somebody decide to enforce it at some point?
I think there isn't. The special permit process doesn't give us that flexibility. It's via special permit. It lets us consider many things.
So,
saying that special permit process doesn't allow us to consider more than one.
Mr. Meares?
Now, the special permit. Oh, that's allowed. That's loud today. The special permit process doesn't allow you to approve something that doesn't comply with the definition. The definition is quite clear. A home occupation is run only by residents, and a special home operation is only by residents plus one non-resident. So if there's somebody out there who is currently in violation of the zoning, there's no way to grandfather an illegal use. There's no amnesty program, and the special permit process won't do it if they're operating if they've only got one employee, they don't need a special permit. If they're in a residential district, they'll just I don't have the chart in front of me, but
if it says that is accessory to the primary residential use and carried on by a resident of the dwelling unit, that doesn't say that they can't have
people working for them. So I don't see how they would be in violation. I mean, it doesn't say, and you may not have any temporary part-time employees working for you. It just says it has to be by a resident of the dwelling. So if that hairdresser has two part-time employees working for them,
they would be in violation.
How? Yes, they would. Well, they would if you enact this, but
they would today be in violation.
How is that in violation?
It's not being carried on exclusively by residents.
Okay, so I guess I'm questioning the wording because it doesn't actually say exclusive. It says carried on by a resident of the dwelling. So if it's carried on by a resident and that resident has an assistant,
then it's not carried on by a resident.
That's how our building inspector currently interprets it. It can only be carried on by someone, a person or people who live in the residence where the business is occurring.
You can have four people if they all live there, right?
Business use conducted and carried on by a resident. Okay. I don't know how I feel about this because I think I just...
You've reached your 10 minutes. Are you almost ready to wrap up?
Yeah, I'm done. Thank you.
Okay. Further discussion? Mr. Barnes.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jonathan Barnes. I just want to ask a question for clarification. I don't necessarily have a strong feeling one way or the other, but I understand the position that the intention of these, other than to allow for the non-resident, is to also ensure that the nature of the single-family residence neighborhoods aren't substantially changed. In the background where you say the primary difference between the home occupation and the special home occupation is that distinction between allowing a non-resident, and I get that, but there is also another difference between home occupation and special home occupation as I see it, in that the home occupation can only be conducted within the dwelling unit, whereas the special home occupation can be conducted within the dwelling unit or accessory structure. So that sort of allows it to expand, allows the home occupation use to expand beyond just the dwelling unit and into an accessory structure, which didn't and doesn't exist for the simple home occupation by the resident. Did you intend for that, and I presume you did because the language is in there, but in keeping with the notion of protecting the integrity of the characteristics of the single-family residence, is the notion that it's still protected because in this case it's by special permit and the neighborhood and the neighbors would be able to at least voice any feeling? Is that how you see that distinction?
Thank you, Jonathan. So two points of clarification. One is that currently with a home occupation, there's not allowed to be any exterior indication except people can store things in sheds. So the building inspector would actually look at more than just the single family dwelling when he was looking at, if he were to look at a home occupation. And then, yes, we are trying to protect the neighborhood by having this be done by a special permit process. So the neighbors would be notified and the CPDC would have a public hearing.
Thank you, but it is also the intention to allow it to expand into that accessory structure on the property, correct?
Yes, as long as it's a permanent structure.
Okay, thank you.
The operation or just the storage?
Right, and as part of the special permit decision.
But to Mrs. Safina's point, if it's only for storage, it doesn't say that, right? I mean, it would allow the home occupation to actually be conducted in the accessory structure. Or am I missing that? A business use conducted within a dwelling unit or within an accessory structure.
Right.
Right, and the current home occupation language just specifies that the business has to be carried on by a resident of the dwelling.
Within the dwelling.
I'm not sure how the building inspector would interpret that, but I believe he would look at the property as a whole. So if it were being conducted in an accessory structure and it wasn't creating any negative impacts to the neighborhood or have any real exterior indication, it would probably be okay.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Mon.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jamie Mon, Precinct 4. A question. If I operated a business out of my home and I had, if this passed and I operated a business out of my home and I had four employees and they operated out of their home, would I be in compliance?
How exactly would they be employed?
Let's say it's an internet business and they sat in their home and worked on their computer.
I think that would be fine.
Okay, and just to follow up, if one day a week or one day a month, one of those four employees came to visit me and had lunch in my house, would I be in compliance?
I mean...
Let me see if I have a liquor license.
You know, if your neighbors started complaining, then we would look into it.
Thank you.
You have to look at this. The intent is to protect that neighborhood, to protect that residential nature of that neighborhood. And if the operation of this business becomes a nuisance and something needs to be done, right? I don't think most of the home occupations are a nuisance.
Further discussion? Ms. Russell? We having trouble hearing? Are you not, maybe you're not close enough? Try it.
Can you hear me now?
Oh, yeah. Okay. I'm going to ask people to speak a little closer. Okay, further discussion? Mr. D'Addario?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Ron D'Addario, Precinct 6. Just going on what Mr. Mon had said, if a person did employ, say, two people, but only one of them worked in the home at one time, so, I mean, it looks like your goal is to have only one non-resident employee in the home at any one time, which would make sense. If you employed three or four or two, but at any one time, only one of them would be there, and not necessarily for lunch, but to work. Or it could be a hairdresser, so she has two assistants, but at any one time, only one is there. It would seem that would be reasonable, and I would hope that might be allowable.
Mr. Savina?
The language does say is employed on the premises. So I think the intent here is that extra employee would be at the premises at the time. That's the issue. If there are three more working wirelessly somewhere else, I don't think that's a concern.
And if there were two employees, but only one at a time, at any one time, would be working within the house, would that be okay?
Yes.
Oh, good, thank you.
These are things that the special permit process would bear out.
Further discussion? Yes, Mr. Pacino.
Phil Pacino, Precinct 5. I've just got a technical question, because it's an issue I dealt with the IRS and Commonwealth of Mass. Do we have a definition of what an employee is versus an outside contractor who may be working in the home?
Okay. I don't think our concern is what the tax issues are. Our concern is the use in that neighborhood. As a planning board anyways, that's the only thing we're...
Well, the whole thing is, I mean, you know, you've used the word employee here. If that person is not defined as an employee by either the IRS or the Commonwealth of Mass, you know, they're defined as an outside contractor, they can claim that, you know, they're not employees and they're not in violation of the section.
Mr. Meares.
I don't see the word employee in the bylaw. The word is employed, which is person is employed, whether they're self-employed and therefore a contractor or they're an employee of the resident. Either way, they're employed. So I don't see that it matters for the purposes of the zoning bylaw whether somebody's an independent contractor or
Further discussion? None appearing. We're ready for the vote. This requires a two-thirds vote. So again, ask my counters to help out. All those in favor of the motion, please raise, right, stand, excuse me, please stand. Please stand, I'm sorry. Mr. Brown, I didn't hear you. 32.
27.
Forty-five. And those opposed?
Zero.
So 2 and 1, okay. The vote being 127 in the affirmative, 3 in the negative, the motion carries. Business under Article 28. Mr. Safina.
Article 28 makes a change to Section 5.4.7.3b, which is performance standards for accessory apartments. So this change was enacted to modify and clarify the available sizes for accessory apartments. It allowed a larger size, which is better for accessibility and mobility impaired residents, which seem to be occupying these. But it still maintains the character of the single family residence. We also changed the wording so that we consistently referred to gross floor area. The prior language was mixing net floor area and gross floor area, causing some confusion. We also changed the gross floor area to be 1,000 square feet, or one-third the gross floor area of the principal residence. In both of those, again, the 1,000 square feet allows more flexibility with the configuration of the apartment, and the one-third gross floor area of the principal structure helps to maintain the look of that structure so that it doesn't start to look like a two-family home or an oversized addition onto that primary residence.
CPDC report?
On Monday, July 11, 2016, the CPDC convened to hold a public hearing on the proposed Article 28. All documents were made available on the town website. Public hearing was held to provide an opportunity for comment and to determine whether the provisions of the proposed zoning bylaw amendment shall be adopted by the town. The July 11th, 2016 public hearing was opened at approximately 8:30 p.m. and the comments received at the hearing were included as part of the record of the hearing. The public hearing was continued to Monday, August 8th, 2016 at 8:30 p.m. to allow time for further discussion and public input. On August 8th, 2016, the hearing was closed. The CPDC voted 300 to recommend the article to town meeting.
Is there further discussion? Mr. Denario.
Ron Denario, Precinct 6. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I would like to add one amendment, and if I might, where it says change from between 400 and 7, okay, to the lesser of 1,000 square feet gross floor area. Right there, I'd like to add with a minimum allowance of 600 square feet.
Let's get that up on the screen.
Your recommendation would have a minimum size for this accessory apartment.
Yeah, it would have a minimum allowance, not a minimum size. They could go lower if they wanted, but with a minimum allowance of 600 square feet.
I'm not sure I understand why.
The why?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Let's get it up there first.
If I could go why, I'll give a little reason, at least as I see it. The reason why I'm saying that is because I was looking at like Brooksby Village, and I could see what was a one-bedroom apartment, and it's basically two areas, and it's around 600 square feet. So I was thinking, well, if you had a smaller home, say 1,400 square feet of a home, so that would give you at one-third around 466 square feet. If you had two people going into it, I'm not saying you can't do it, but it might be a little tight. So my feeling was if you went to give them at least the allowance to hit 600 square feet, that would certainly be a little more than one-third of the 1,400 square feet, but might not enough to make a dramatic change to the structure of the building. So my feeling is that 600 square feet might be just a little more livable if you were to have, possibly an older mother and father living in the apartment. So that's why I would ask you to consider maybe allowing at least 600 feet if they chose to do it. Thank you.
Okay, before we continue, let's get it up on the screen so people know what we're discussing.
Right, it would be, trying to see. Is, okay, 1,000 square feet, which says 1,000 square feet. With a minimum, would say.
Why don't you just let me do it?
I'm trying to see it. With a minimum allowance of 1,000 square feet, or one-third of the gross floor area of the principal single-family dwelling, with a minimum allowance of 600 square feet.
Here, let me give it a try.
One-third, Right, that's good, and I like it that you said may have. I mean, if they want to go to 400 square feet, that's fine. But at least they'll have that option, especially if there were to be two people.
Okay, is there a second to that? Second. I would ask that, according to our bylaws, we need to have these in writing so we know exactly what your wording is, rather than trying to do this on the floor. But is there further discussion on the proposed amendment? That's what we're on now. Mr. O'Neill.
John O'Neill, Precinct 4. I would support the amendment. I'm thinking in terms of people of limited mobility, walkers, wheelchairs, that sort of thing. We're talking about accessory apartments. I think oftentimes we're talking about older people, I would imagine, but not necessarily. You have people with other kinds of disabilities. And so 400 square feet would make it very difficult for someone, because you have to have, wider doorways, you want to have pathways that have to be, a certain width and everything else. So I would support the proposed amendment.
Further discussion? Yes, in the far end. Far back.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Tony Tor, Precinct 1. We want to be careful that we're going to start dictating what people, you know, put setting a minimum size addition or apartment they can put on their home. Maybe they can't afford 600 square feet. I mean, I don't have a problem with a maximum, but we want to be careful. You know, we're going to start dictating, you know, what size you can build. You know, the building code provides minimum room sizes. You know, we can't start forcing people's hands and saying, you know, you may, you know, if you're going to have handicapped or whatever your issue is, and you have to build a certain size. I mean, that's kind of going down a different path. I don't think we need to be doing that.
It is worded to say may, though. It's not a minimum size.
Mr. Crook? No, no. Okay. Further discussion on the amendment, Mr. Hartzler?
Glenn Hartzler, Precinct 4. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Just another possibility, instead of the amendment as put up there in blue, we change the not to exceed the lesser of, not make that read not to exceed the greater of. So the smallest house could still have a 1,000 square foot accessory apartment, and then as the houses get bigger, they become limited to 1/3 of their gross floor area.
Further discussion?
I don't think that's the right way to word.
Mr. Savina?
The zoning, okay. Not the greater of. I think that'd be difficult to administer. Really? Okay. We don't usually write it the greater of. It's usually the lesser of when you give two numbers like that.
Further discussion? Yes.
Steve Herrick, Precinct 8. I guess my concern with the amendment is that there may actually be apartments in place based on the current bylaw, which this would make illegal, except for the may. And if we include the may in there, I don't understand what the point of it is. I understand the sentiment behind it, but it seems like we're just opening a gray area. I certainly wouldn't want to put the people who are currently living in a 500 square foot accessory apartment into a situation where suddenly they're like, are we legal or aren't we legal? It seems to add unclarity in my mind.
Further discussion? Those who've not spoken yet, Mr. Tuttle?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Dave Tuttle of Precinct 3 and a member of the CPDC. This has come up, you know, the 600 square feet, the size of the accessory apartment, and so forth, has come up several times over the last 2 or 3 years. And I am still amazed at people's lack of measuring skills, if you will. I have a two-bedroom Cape on the Cape, which is, the basic unit is 720 square feet. It's two full-size bedrooms, a living room, kitchen, a dining area, and a bathroom. Now, 600 square feet is not small, but I wouldn't want to be able to put a 600 square foot accessory apartment on a 720 square foot house. I don't know how many tiny houses we have in Reading, but I think that the original wording was carefully stated and clarified by switching to use of the gross floor area. And I don't think that the amendment is at all required.
Further discussion on the amendment? None appearing. Are we ready for the vote? All those in favor of the proposed amendment, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion does not carry. We are now back into discussion on the main motion. Further discussion? None appearing. This requires a 2/3 vote. All those in favor, please rise.
Twenty-three.
47. And those opposed?
Zero.
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 Two.
Zero.
Zero. The vote being 132 in the affirmative, 2 in the negative, the motion carries. Business under Article 29, Mr. Safina.
These amendments make changes to Section 5.5 for accessory buildings or structures. So the entire section was reorganized by use into the following categories: general provisions, garages, home recreational facilities, other accessory buildings or structures, and special permit uses. So for garages, this added flexibility to allow detached one-story garages as close as 5 feet to the rear.
Mr. Safina, could you speak closer to the microphone again? I'm sorry.
For garages, this added flexibility to allow detached one-story garages as close as 5 feet to rear or side property lines. The existing bylaw currently requires 10-foot setbacks. One-story limit for garages within the required setback or rear setback. So we clarified what one-story meant. Basically, it's measured from the slab to the top plate, which is the first horizontal member at the top of a stud. No greater than 9 feet. It does not allow for dormers or windows on the side roofs, and provides for no full staircase. And what that does is prohibit habitation, occupation of that garage, which is supposed to be an accessory structure. We added a category to provide separate regulations for pools, sports courts, et cetera, and to exempt such facilities from the lot coverage requirements. That seemed to be a restriction that was causing some issues. For lot coverage, we added, clarified that only garages and structures used for storage are subject to the lot coverage requirements. We added the flexibility to allow the following: storage trailers and containers located within a required setback, and temporary storage units on site for less than 30 days do not need a special permit.
That's it. CPDC report.
So Monday, July 29th, CPDC convened to hold a public hearing on the proposed Article 29. All documents were made available on the town website. The public hearing was held to provide an opportunity for comment and to determine whether the provisions of the proposed zoning bylaw amendment shall be adopted by the town. July 11th public hearing was opened at approximately 8:30 p.m. Any comments received at the hearing were included as part of the record of the hearing. Public hearing was continued to Monday, August 8th, 2016 at 8:30 p.m. and again to Monday, August 22nd, 2016 at 9 p.m. to allow time for further discussion and public input. On August 28th, 2016, the hearing was closed. The CPDC voted 4-0-0 to recommend Article 29 to town meeting.
Further discussion? Mr. Dodario.
Ron Dodario, Precinct 6. I just have one question. On the home recreational facility, where you're talking swimming pool, tennis court, sports court, it says it shall be permitted at any size, and provided that it conforms to the required side yard, et cetera. And then it goes down a little on that same paragraph. It says, however, that it shall be no larger than the greater of 600 square feet or 25% of the gross floor area of the principal structure. So does that mean a tennis court could be no greater than 600 feet? Is that what that means? I didn't understand it.
So it's worded a little tricky, but basically if a home recreational facility complies with the zoning setbacks, it can be any size. If it does not comply with the zoning setbacks, it's restricted to 600 square feet or 25% of the setback area.
Oh, if it doesn't comply. Oh, I guess is that what it says? A home may be located with a required, I just, is that what it says in the writing? I'm just, I hear you. That says that? Okay.
Yes.
All right, thank you.
Further discussion? Mr. Barnes?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jonathan Barnes. Nick, can you do me a favor and put up the slide, the first two slides that you had explaining the motion, the one just before that, please? Okay. Garages, added flexibility to allow detached one-story, as close as 5 feet, okay. Thank you. In that 5.5.1.2, I have just two questions. In B, if I'm reading it correctly, that's sort of the same issue that I think Mr. Daddario raised, but in that section, if the garage meets the setback requirements, then the structure, the garage, can be permitted up to the maximum height. So that could, in fact, be two stories, correct? Okay, thank you. And I just wanted to make sure, forgive me, I don't know whether I very much appreciate the fact that you included the cross out the strike-through version and the bold version. I find that very helpful. I'm not sure whether this was just a test to see if anybody was insane enough to actually read that bold and strike through as compared to the other one, but sadly I am. But in the strike through, in that section, in the strike through area on 5.5.1.2, I think I know the answer to this because the motion this evening didn't include this, but that B states at the end of it, it says, and is permitted at any size. I'm assuming that should not be there, and I know it's not in the final version, but it's, the suggestion isn't that it can be at any size. Am I correct in that?
Can you cite that section again, please?
Yeah, in the bolder strike-through version of it, which is page 76 on 5512B, it actually says, shall be permitted to utilize the maximum height permitted for a principal structure in the same zoning district, comma, and is permitted at any size. I'm assuming that's gone in the other one, but I'm just assuming that shouldn't be there, correct?
It's supposed to be there.
But that's not in the actual final version. In the actual final version on page 73, it doesn't have that last part about and is permitted at any size. It's not that it's permitted in any size, it's restricted to 5.5.1.1F, I think. Am I correct? I mean, I think it... No. I mean, the actual final version and the actual motions that town meeting saw tonight in the final version of 5.5.1.2 does not include that added language and is permitted at any size. But I was just a little confused when I saw it in the strike through one, so I just want to make sure we're all of the same mind on that.
We're trying to track it down right now.
Page 73 is the previous motion, I think.
I'm not sure who said that, but page 73 is the previous motion. Okay, so is it in the final motion? Because I understood that garage that is within the regular setbacks certainly can be within 5 feet, but I understood that it was restricted in size to the 25% with 600 square feet. It's not that it could be at any size, I did not believe.
Mr. Biaris.
This is the final version. What do you have?
Okay, so.
It's not in the end.
Looks like I edited it because the previous thing says permitted up to the maximum height permitted for a principal structure in the same zoning district. And then the next part of it said, and is permitted in any size. And I said, well, that contradicts what went before. So I took it out. told that what it was intended to mean was it is permitted in any floor area. The height is, of course, restricted. But I don't think that's needed, so I'm going to stand by my edit that it should stay out.
So, thank you. So if I'm understanding, then you're saying that that "and is permitted any size" is out. So does that mean then that it is restricted in size by 5.5.1.1F? Or what is it governed by in terms of the size that it can be, other than the height of the principal structure?
There are other factors like lot coverage, there are other setbacks, there's the location of the principal structure, which would start to impede how big you can get.
Well, I guess, I'm sorry, I'm just not understanding that, and this is pretty confusing, but when I read it, I clearly see that within 5.5.1.2, it does not address the size of that particular structure as long as it meets the setbacks. So I then went back up to 5.5.1.1F.
Correct.
Oh, that is correct.
Yep.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Do I still have a minute or so?
Okay, yeah, about a minute. Yeah,
thank you.
5% of the gross floor area of the structure.
Okay, so this is, you intended to be exempt from F or not?
Either 600 square feet or 25% of the gross floor area of the principal structure, whichever is greater. There's a contradiction to what we said before.
So it is covered by that?
It is subject to F.
Okay, thank you. Then my second question had to do with C, where we're now talking about detached garages that are simply within the side yard or rear yard, but not necessarily within the setback. And I do understand that they can be no less than 5 feet. And you say that the height is restricted to one story. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And again, forgive me, I'm not a professional with that. But is that because, Nick, of the requirement where it says she'll have a slab to top plate height no greater than 9 feet? I mean, what is it that restricts it to one story, I guess, is what I'm asking.
That's what we used as our criteria after consulting with some professionals who are building these all over town.
Okay, I didn't necessarily understand that myself professionally, but that if that top plate is the horizontal at the top of the wall, is that correct?
It's the spring line where the roof would start to peak, where your roof rafter would sit. Right,
but so that being the case, doesn't that mean that there's no restriction governing the roof height, correct? Or is it? So that's the top plate, which is where the roof bottom would be, but the roof could go up as without any other restriction, as high as anybody wanted.
What was happening before?
No, that's a different section. The restriction to no higher than the principal structure is if it's within the setback area. This is not within the setback area, so I'm just trying to understand how the height restriction of the full structure, including the roof. I get that the top plate can't be any higher than 9 feet, but what restricts the roof? Because this is not covered by B. This is not within the setback area, unless I'm wrong about that.
Right. Well, there's only so high you can go before you become vertical again. This allowed for the angle of the roof to be more attractive, if you will. If you said that the whole building could only be 12 feet high, then you'd end up with very low pitch roofs which don't necessarily match the housing, the house roofs that go with it. So a 25 foot wide, 30 foot wide garage, right, with a 9 foot spring line, even at 12 and 12 is only gonna be 10 feet higher than that, 19 feet.
Okay, so I guess I would say, if you guys say so, I mean, I understood that it can't be any high, the top plate can't be 9 feet. As long as you're telling me that one could not construct a roof in that scenario that could allow for a second story.
There are other restrictions in there that prevent the second story, the full staircase, no dormers, no windows, and the
roof. Oh, okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
All set. There was a hand up in the back. Yes. Ms. Young.
Nancy Toomey, Precinct 3. I'm very concerned that we're leaving the language out that is at the end of 5.5.1.2b and is permitted at any size. I think once that garage gets beyond the setbacks, what keeps it from being anything? I mean, I think the whole point of this is so that we don't end up with a structure that's close to the neighbors. So I could take, for example, a 2x4 and connect my structure to the house, and the building official would say it's connected. Then I could do anything I wanted with that accessory structure. It wouldn't be an accessory structure anymore. I guess what I'm saying is restricting it by size, we already have a restriction by lot coverage. That's huge. Trying to keep it within that 25% is enough. But if I had a 3-car garage and I had a big piece of property, you're telling me I couldn't put a 3-car garage on my property, even though it's allowed. So I really think that we need that sentence or that completion of that sentence to say that it can be unlimited in size and not restricted to 600 square feet.
Because you're reading that as restricting garages that are...
Right, if I don't have a house, say my house, I have a cape that's 2,400 square feet, and I'm on a 3-acre piece of property. I could only have a 600 square foot garage even though I'm within the setback. That seems very restrictive. Yeah, I have a 2,400 square foot house. It's telling me I have to do a percentage of my house, right? So I have a 3-acre piece of property. I want a barn out and back, and I can only do 600 square feet. To me, that seems very restrictive on my piece of property. As long as I'm conforming, there shouldn't be any restriction on other than lot coverage on that structure.
Because you're reading that section to apply to...
Right. You just said that it applies to accessory structures. Correct. So if I need to make an amendment to put it back in, I make an amendment to add back in the comma after district in 5.5.1.2.
Mr. Mayor,
you don't want the language that was there.
Okay.
I will draft something right now.
Draft something up. Yeah, okay. That would make it work because I really think we need to have that determination in there.
Again, I ask that we have these in writing. It makes it much clearer if they're already set before we start working on them.
I didn't realize it wasn't in. Sorry.
Mr. Tuttle?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I'm not sure I understand why we're looking at the section on garages when we already have 5511G, which says accessory structures other than garages and structures used for storage shall be exempt from lot coverage requirements. So if you've got a 3-acre lot, you can put whatever you want for accessory structures as long as it's not a garage and it's not in the required side yard, which is by definition the setback.
Are you drafting a proposed amendment?
Yes. Thank you. That looks good.
Is that what you're looking at? Okay, is there a second to that? Second. Okay, all discussion is now on that proposed amendment. Further discussion? Yes, over in the...
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Tony Durezzo, Precinct 2. The reason originally that we were, my understanding, CPDC was attempting to limit the size of a garage is kind of the exact scenario that the last person explained, in that they have a small house and they put a 4,000 square foot garage on the property. The idea was that your main principal residence should be the larger structure. So if you're looking at a 2,400 square foot house and you want an extra 1,000 square feet of storage, you can perfectly well do that just so long as you attach it to the prime structure. So if you're looking to have a small house and a huge garage, that is what you're looking for here. If you're trying to keep them in something of a perspective that the house will always be larger than the garage, that is why you'd limit it to 25%. Thank you.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Mr. Barnes.
Jonathan Barnes, Precinct 5. First of all, I apologize for having done this at this particular point. I agree, it would be better to have participated along the way before we got to this point, so I apologize about that. But having said that, we're here and these issues are important. So I guess the only thing I would say is I was not in favor originally when I asked the question of permitting a garage simply because it met the 15-foot or 20-foot side yard or rear yard setback. I was not in favor of allowing that property owner to construct a garage of any size that they wanted. And if this does that, then I do not support that, and I would urge others not to support it. I understand the previous speaker's question or issue about a property owner of a substantial property, and that's a valid point, which may be able to be addressed by, rather than phrasing it this way, and I know Town Council just did it this way, sort of off on the fly, but perhaps I would think if he would entertain as a friendly amendment, maybe it would be better to limit it rather than to allow it to be exempt in all ways from a size restriction, to have it be limited to 25% of the acre and a half or whatever. I would think that a 25% or any other figure, but something like that would be better. To the previous speaker's point, while it may all be a valid consideration to allow a property owner of an acre or an acre and a half who complies with the setbacks to have a three-car garage of rather substantial size, that would also allow a property owner, if we leave it this way, of a 15,000 square foot property or a 20,000 square foot property, depending on where they are, as long as they comply with the 15 foot or 20 foot setback, to also have a garage of any size they desired. And I do not think that's appropriate. Thank you.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment? None appearing. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion does not carry. We're back to discussion on the main amendment under 29. Further discussion? Yes, Mr. Sasso.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. John Sasso, Precinct 2. And Jonathan, yes, I was up late. I read and found that same discrepancy. But so in addition, I have a quick friendly amendment to make to Section 5512. Paragraph A, all garages shall be subject to lot coverage requirements.
Oh, it's missing the word B? Yes, okay. Is that acceptable to the mover? Yes, is there any objection? Not appearing, we'll accept that as part of the main motion.
And then, Mr. Daddario, I also was a little confused with the wording in that section, and I was gonna make a suggestion here in section 5513, again, I apologize, no glasses here. In the second line, facility shall be permitted at any size provided that it is not located within the required side yard and required rear yard setbacks for a principal structure in the same zoning district. I think the confusion was exactly that you use different wording in the section, and so in one section it didn't differentiate it. So now you say clearly it's not, if it's not located, then you have the ability to be permitted at any size, and then if it is located within those required setbacks, then it has to be limited. So just that's a clarification.
All right, let's just get that wording up there.
Is not located in the required, there you go, yep.
Okay, is that the way you see it?
Yes,
okay, sir. Is there a second to that? Second, okay, discussion on that proposed amendment.
Thank you.
None appearing. All those in favor of the proposed amendment, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Back to the main motion again. Further discussion. Yes, Mr. Phillips.
Gary Phillips, Precinct 7. I'd like to move that we strike two line items under 5.512. Item D, I move that we strike item 2 and 3. Yes.
Okay. Is there a second? Second. Mr. Phillips?
My rationale is simply this. I've yet to ever encounter a garage where people don't use the attic for storage. Our garage is of an older age, and the second level, which is an attic, has a window at each end of the each end of the building on the second floor. And one of the first things we did was eliminate the pull-down staircase and put in a permanent staircase inside the building. And I just don't see any reason why this should be a prohibition. If people have fears of an attic being used for a residence, then they'd be in non-compliance with the codes that do exist. So I just think that this is unnecessary. And there are instances where I see people install a, window dormers in the front of their garage on the second floor. And in many instances, I think it actually enhances the appearance of the garage, the structure. So I think it's just unnecessary and causes people to forfeit a benefit to their property. Thank you.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment? Yes. Mr. DiRezzo?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Tony DiRezzo, Precinct 2. Just a reminder, this only applies to garages that are within the required side or rear yard, which means the idea was to limit the size to make sure you weren't overshadowing your neighbor's yard. If your garage is inside the setbacks, you can make it two stories, you can have the full staircase, and you can have the dormers. Once again, this was only for those garages that are near the lot line, so you do not overshadow your neighbor. Thank you.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Yes, Ms. Doctor?
Thanks, Nancy Doctor, Precinct 1. I also, I guess, had the same kind of concern about windows or dormers on garages. Seems like you eliminate, a skylight, correct? That would be...
This prohibition was strictly on the roof. So no dormer breaking through the roof and no window.
So a skylight would also be included in that, correct? Would that be considered a window? On the roof line?
I mean, we could be more specific about it. I don't think we considered skylights. You are allowed windows on the gable end, the wall end.
The slant. So, but not on the slant.
Not on the roof.
Right, that's what I'm saying. So that would be a skylight that you're not allowing.
I think the intent here was not to allow the roof to break so that you started increasing height, which then made that space habitable.
Right, but if I don't want to put my car in the garage, but I want to be able to use my garage. It would prevent additional light into the garage, correct?
Yeah, I mean, I would have no objection to skylights.
Okay, thank you.
The intent here was not to create buildings that are within this setback area that is right up against your neighbor's house and now start breaking through that roof to add habitable space.
To add height. To add height. Thank you.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Mr. Daddario?
Ron Daddario, Precinct 6. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Just to maybe a friendly amendment is to make number 2 and number 3 separate. I mean, it's possible that a dormer might be intrusive to a neighbor. I could see that. But as far as the full staircase, I'm assuming that's inside the garage. Is that true? I mean, if somebody wanted a full staircase inside the garage, it would help them, and maybe they had a storage area up there. I mean, why would we want to stop that? I don't think it does anything to the neighbor. It just makes it a little easier. As I get older, I begin to realize the difficulty of staircases. Maybe if we could separate the amendment into two, we could at least work to keep number 3. Thank you.
Further discussion? Yes, Mr. Barnes.
Jonathan Barnes, Precinct 5. In terms of the amendment, am I understanding that the amendment is intended to strike both Roman numeral 2 or little I 2, little I 3, little 3I, little 2I?
Correct.
But Mr. Safina, if I understood the previous discussion about the height of the roof, am I correct that you suggested that these were among the specific standards or requirements that prohibited a property owner from having a second floor in these garages?
Makes it more difficult, yes.
That being the case, then I would not be in favor of striking them. Thank you.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment? Not appear.
It's more difficult to have a habitable space, certainly usable for storage.
Mr. Sylvester?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Paul Sylvester, Precinct 3. And the question that I have is, knowing how clever people can be, wouldn't I get around most of your restrictions by simply building my garage in a gambrel shape? And I could have a nice set of steep sides going up and then break the roof over, and I could have a full second floor up there as long as I didn't exceed the height requirements of my primary dwelling, I think. And I'm just wondering, are we forcing people in that direction? And, you know, same kind of thing in terms of, you know, windows and dormers. You know, I just have a small garage. I do use the upstairs for storage. As I get older, I get more and more scared about carrying things up on a ladder and such. So I just wonder about, you know, some of the practical aspects, even though I'm in favor of the kinds of controls that it's putting on. I just don't want us to miss that issue that, you know, there may be other ways to get around what we're trying to prevent.
Mr. Safina?
Well, we're certainly not trying to dictate style. We really are trying to limit the mass of these structures on those smaller lots where we start to infringe on our neighbor's property. Certainly, if you live on a one-acre lot, you have a lot more flexibility than the quarter-acre and smaller lots. And I think this sort of language has come around many times, and we always struggle with size. What is the right size and whatnot? And we did ask for help from some of the professionals who are building things out there to see what would be appropriate. We looked at a few roof configurations and thought that the 9-foot plate height gave flexibility to the roof architecture, to the style of that, rather than just a low flat.
And limiting breaking through the roof would limit your head height in there, not make it a very good habitable space. If you built a gambrel, you might be pushing the height limits of the regular building. And if you only had windows on the ends, you might not get enough light deeper into the space without something from the side. We certainly can't capture every single possible architectural style. We really are just trying to limit the mass of these structures in that setback zone.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment? Yes. Mr. Bonazzoli.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. James Bonazzoli, Precinct 6. This makes sense to me. I'm in favor of it. But then I was brought to my attention, I think my garage would then become non-conforming. The issue that I have, primarily, I mean, I can't stand fully when I bring things up to a garage, but I do have a full set of stairs that was there when we bought the house in 95. So I would imagine if anybody went did work, whether we did or after we sold it, it's now non-conforming. Would they make them remove the stairs to the garage upstairs if this was enacted? No? It would not? Okay.
Can't go back.
Mr. Meares?
So those stairs are protected non-conforming component of the structure. So there is no way that they can be lawfully made to be removed.
Great. Carry on.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment? Yes. Ms. Cooper?
Kendra Cooper, Precinct 8. As I originally was in favor of this, and then when I listened to Gary Phillips, and then I thought more about the difficulties we have, even getting into the attic with the pull down stairs and things. I think that if we pass it the way it is and not with the amendment, we're going to be actually promoting a safety hazard among the community members. I understand that pre-existing structures aren't affected, but I can certainly see how by restricting the sources of light and by having restricting people from constructing a full staircase. I know of many structures that you have a staircase and you duck down and everything, but it's a whole lot easier to duck down going up a staircase than it is ducking down, trying to balance on a ladder, trying to bring things up. And I would urge people to vote for this amendment. Thank you.
Yes, right down in front.
John Weston, Precinct 7 and CPDC member. I just want people to remember that this amendment we're talking about is just for the structures that are in the side yard, the side and rear yard setback. So if these get deleted and someone can build like a gambrel or a mansard style structure 5 feet off of the property line. So you could have that garage staring 5 feet over you, two stories high, plus the you know, however high it can end up getting. And so it's just that, it's just those structures that we're talking about here, putting these restrictions on, that are in the required setback. It was an attempt to try and keep those so that those garages don't impose on your neighbor, not to impose these rules on every garage that's built in town.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment? Yes. Ms. Webb?
Lane Webb, Precinct 1. I don't support the amendment because I think we need to keep these controls in place, and it just strikes me as odd that we passed an amendment that sort of eliminated the ability for someone to create a potentially larger garage, like someone who has a big enough house and big enough land to have potentially a three-car garage. We've sort of eliminated that by applying 5.5.1F, potentially. So in a spot where there might be plenty of space and it's far away from the lot line, we're okay with restricting, But here, where we're talking about it being within 5 feet, 5 feet is not very far. I'm 5'3". That's how close it is to the lot line. And we don't want to have these special protections in. I think this is crazy. I don't think we should support that amendment.
Further discussion? Yes.
Nancy Toomey, Precinct 3. Just some clarification. I was a bit involved in coming up with these restrictions. The building official, building inspector, is worried about habitable space on a second floor. And when we get these garages, to Ms. Webb's point, at 5 feet off the property line, there are several ways you can limit that second floor. One of them that was proposed was to restrict the height of the roof. However, if you have a 24-foot garage and you restrict the height to, say, 12 feet, you end up with a very flat roof. There are some beautiful homes in Reading. I have one in particular that I'm working right now that has a gambrel roof. So to put a garage, a detached structure next to it for a two-car garage and only be able to put a three-pitch on that roof, you end up with a shed-looking garage. So as an architect trying to preserve the look and feel and character of the town of Reading, we really want to have the flexibility of being able to take roofs that match the house as we apply them to the garage. So as an assurance to the building official, by eliminating windows on the sides of the roof, and yeah, I would love to have windows on the sides of the roof, and eliminating the opportunity to have a full staircase on these particular garages, and limiting the height of the top plate, which is really the ceiling height of that garage, I felt, and they felt, the CPDC felt, that this was a good way to assure the building official that people will have to go through major hoops to make that into an apartment or any kind of accessible, habitable space on the second floor. I do not support this amendment for that reason.
Further discussion on the amendment. Mr. Daddario.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Ron Daddario, Precinct 6. I would like to ask Mr. Phillips if, in his amendment to eliminate Roman numeral 2 and 3, would he agree to separate them so that it would be two amendments? And my reason for this is that if we decide not to go with the dormers, we may still wish to have a full staircase, which merely allows people to get to a second level for storage in a safer way. It doesn't demand that they put it in. It's just allows for an option. The staircases are inside the dwelling. They're not going to be seen by anybody. It just gives them that possibility.
Actually, Mr. Daddario, I missed your point before. I will separate those two. It makes sense to have them as two separate things.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Further, you are okay with that too? It really is, they're still both coming up. Okay, further discussion on what we now have is two amendments. Okay, not appearing, we will first vote on eliminating just Roman numeral 2. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, and the motion does not carry. Now we have an amendment, proposed amendment on eliminating Roman numeral 3. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, and the motion does not carry. Further business on the main motion. Yes.
Tom Grant, Precinct 4. I might have been looking at this too long, but in section 5.5.1.1, letters F and G, it seems like G might contradict F, unless I don't understand what lot coverage requirements are. It seems like G is saying accessory structures are exempt from lot coverage requirements, but F says accessory buildings or structures have lot coverage requirements of 600 square feet or 25.
G is meant Mr. Savina?
I'm sorry, G is meant to exempt sheds and
structures that are not garages. Item G is meant to exempt sheds and smaller, other than garages and structures.
There's a difference between the footprint of a building and the overall lot coverage. So in most of the residential districts in town, lot coverage is 25%. So what this is saying is that accessory structures other than garages and structures used for storage shall be exempt from lot coverage, meaning that they don't apply to that 25%. And in F, it's saying that an accessory building or structure that is not an accessory apartment may have a footprint that is either 600 square feet or 25% of the gross floor area, the principal structure. So there are two different aspects of the building dimension.
Okay, so footprint and lot coverage requirements are different things.
Yes.
Got it, okay. And if I just might make a request for those of us who are relatively new to town meeting, for people who are from the town, if they might identify themselves before they begin speaking, if they're not so identified by the moderator. Thank you.
Yes. Further discussion on the main motion? None appearing. This requires,
Yes, I'm hoping this would be taken as a friendly amendment. 5.5.1 point F.
Could you identify yourself?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm not from the town officials. Bruce McKenzie, Precinct 8. 5.5.1 point F. It seems to me that it could be interpreted to require exactly 600 square feet, so I propose an amendment to strike the words may have a footprint that is either. May have a footprint that is either. I'd be happy if you reword this and replace it with shall not have a footprint greater than. Shall not have a footprint greater than. And please reword this if you feel appropriate. I hate making amendments on wording from the floor like this. Thank you. So the explanation is just someone might interpret it, you can't have a small one, or, you know, maybe you can have one of any size.
Is there a second to that? Second. Mr. Miharis, do you have? Yes. Okay.
I'm going to do some drafting, okay?
Okay. While we're drafting that, is there discussion on that proposed amendment? If not, we'll wait till it's drafted. You all set with that? That the way you want it? Okay, is there further discussion on that proposed amendment? Mr. McKenzie?
Could that be a friendly amendment?
Is that accepted by the proponents, or if not, we'll take a vote. We'll continue as if it's a, we're going to take a vote. Is there further discussion on that? None appearing. All those in favor of that amendment, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Okay. Now we're back to the main motion again. Any discussion? None appearing. This requires a two-thirds vote. All those in favor, please rise. Twenty-seven. 35.
28.
28. 47. Excuse me?
47.
47. And those opposed?
Zero.
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 Zero. The vote being 137 in the affirmative, zero in the negative, the motion carries. Business under Article 30. Mr. Safina.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Nick Safina, Precinct 3 and CPDC Chair. Article 30 changes regard Section 6.2.1 for lot shape. It's important to remember that this only applies, this rule only applies to newly created lots. It makes the regulation more straightforward. It eliminated the formula. I don't know if many of you had to deal with it before, but it was intriguing at best. And it prevents, this is to prevent the creation of oddly configured lots that are very narrow or have acute angles. And this diagram might help to understand how it's written now, but basically we're requiring that minimum width through the required front yard to the principal face of the building.
That's it, okay, for CPDC report.
On Monday, July 11th, 2016, the CPDC convened to hold a public hearing on the proposed Article 30. All documents were made available on the town website. The public hearing was held to provide an opportunity for comment and to determine whether the provisions of the proposed zoning bylaw amendment shall be adopted by the town. The July 11th, 2016 public hearing was opened at approximately 8:30 p.m. Any comments received at the hearing were included as part of the record of the hearing. Public hearing was continued to Monday, August 8th, 2016 at 8:30 p.m. to allow time for further discussion and public input. On August 8th, 2016, the hearing was closed. The CPDC voted 300 to recommend Article 30 to town meeting.
Further discussion? Mr. Mann.
Jamie Mann, Precinct 4. Does it state somewhere else in the bylaws what that minimum width is?
Section 6. So each district has its, there's a table that shows you the minimum site criteria per district.
So the minimum lot width is already in effect, so I'm not totally clear on what this does if we already have a minimum lot width.
In the prior version of the code, or in the current version of the code, there's a formula that you have to figure out. It's very difficult to explain, that's why we changed it. But basically, what it prevents is lots that, the old pork chop lot, right, not having enough frontage or having very odd angles to create land that then you can build on somehow. Disruptive from the pattern of the neighborhood.
But if there was a minimum lot width, didn't it have to meet that minimum width?
I don't think width was always the issue. It was just, it's how you come up with the shape of the lot.
Well, does this proposed change only apply to the width of the lot in front of the structure, or does it apply to the width of the lot for its entire depth?
It's just the front. That's the part that affects the character of that neighborhood.
So you could still have a triangular lot as long as it meets that minimum width in front of the structure.
The new language also has a provision that the angles formed by the side lot lines as they approach the front lot line need to be no less than 45 degrees.
But the back lot line,
yes.
Your lot could still come to a point.
Yes.
Right, but the back lines don't really impact the neighborhood. They don't impact the character of that neighborhood.
once you get past the residence, what happens back there doesn't matter so much.
Further discussion?
Thank you.
Mr. Crook.
Stephen Crook, Precinct 2. So with this proposed wording, I could build on the back of the lot, along the back lot line. I could make a section that ran hundreds or even thousands of feet over, say, towards that exit door, by 2, 3, 4 feet wide. The example that comes to my mind is I'm acquainted with a lot on a cul-de-sac down in the Wood End area, where most of the lot is relatively rectangular, but it has a little narrow strip, I believe about 6 feet wide by many hundreds of feet long, that runs behind the adjoining lot, which permitted the developer to get one more lot on, because he could make the lot area that way by making a little skinny pork chop. And I thought the function of the formula we had before, which was perimeter to area ratio, addressed that sort of thing. I'm not sure I see that this achieves that goal.
There's additional language in here, of course. It says each lot shall have, in addition to the required frontage, the required minimum lot width at all points between the required frontage and the nearest point of the front wall of the dwelling.
Okay. Further discussion? Mr. Tuttle?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Dave Tuttle of Precinct 3. This is one of several constraints in terms of the new lots. One of the determinations of a buildable lot involves the, and I've forgotten the precise term that we use, but the minimum circle. As you have to have, for a buildable lot, you have to have the appropriate frontage on a public way, and you have to have a circle of a minimum dimension that is can contained by the lot, large enough to consider it a buildable lot. In the existing bylaw, there is a third provision, which is the lot shape, and the lot shape requires a detailed survey and measurement, which is actually fairly expensive. And this is an alternative to the lot shape. It does not override the minimum frontage, does not override the need for the minimum circle. It's just a simplification to reduce the complexity.
Further discussion? Anybody hasn't spoken yet? Mr. Mon.
Jamie Mon, Precinct 4. To that point, then are we striking the previous complex requirement that you just referred to? Where is that in the proposed amendment?
It's 6.2.1B.
You have a point of order? Ms. Could you use the microphone? I'm sorry. We can't hear you. Ms. Schneider.
Gina Snyder, Precinct 5. Jamie, aren't you asking about the other provisions that Mr. Tuttle mentioned, not this one? Yes.
So this,
I think Jamie's asking if we're changing those or if they stay as they are about the circle and the square and stuff.
We're not changing anything, right, except for 6.2.1 lot shape, and the article reads that we're deleting it in its entirety and replacing it with what you see here in the warrant, with these two paragraphs.
Further,
we're getting rid of the formula. I can read you the formula if you'd like to hear it. The square footage of the lot multiplied by 22 shall be greater than the length of the perimeter of the lot squared. This just says
Each lot shall have, in addition to the required frontage, the required minimum lot width at all points between the required frontage at the street and the point of the nearest front wall, which is this shaded area that you see here.
Further discussion? Yes, on the edge.
Doug Webb, Precinct 1. Is there a difference, and if there is, can you explain the difference between minimum lot width and required frontage?
Mr. Savina?
Well, the minimum lot width is the frontage in this case. As far as lot shape is concerned, the minimum front width is the frontage.
So then are you saying that all lots will have to come square off the front? You couldn't have any lots with any pie shape to them? If you want, say, a 100-foot frontage, you'll need to have 100 feet back 20 feet?
Mr. Miyares.
So frontage is the dimension of the lot along the public way. Okay, so right at the edge, that's the frontage.
I got that part.
Lot width is a requirement that extends from that point all the way back to the front of the house.
So is the lot width at the front of the house the same as the frontage?
No, not necessarily.
Then what is the lot, or it could be greater, but it can't be less than the frontage?
So if you look at the table on 6.3, for example, in an S15 district, the frontage requirement is 100 feet. Lot width is 60 feet.
Okay, so there is a difference.
It allows it to be, it has to be 100 feet at the street, but it can then narrow it to as little as 60 feet.
Great.
After the front house. Up to the front house.
100.
Now 100 is required on the street. Just have a required minimum lot at all points between the required frontage and the nearest point on the front wall. So from there back to the house.
Right. So there is a difference between the two.
Further discussion? Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Karen Herrick, Precinct 8. I've had a quick question about the implication of the use of right-of-way in this language versus a public way. What does that mean?
Legally?
Mr. Savina?
The right-of-way is the extent of the roadway from the center line out to some portion of the back of the sidewalk, if you will. That's the right-of-way.
Okay. Is this a common usage in the bylaw? This seems like a new thing to me, so I'm wondering.
That's the typical usage for the roadway, public roadway.
Can it mean any roadway, private, public?
I believe so, yeah.
I was just wondering if it was a more generic term, and perhaps that's why it was being used.
Generic term. I mean, that's the proper term to use to understand where the property begins and where the extents of the road go beyond the paved area, typically. So that is the right-of-way.
Okay, thank you. And I can confirm what Mr. Tuttle said, that the current formula is incredibly complex and does require, you're going to need to hire a surveyor to do any math. So I'm in favor of simplifying the bylaws and making things clearer and easier. Thank you.
Further discussion? None appearing. Are we ready for the vote? All those in favor, please rise.
Twenty-seven.
And those opposed?
Zero.
Zero. Vote being 134 in the affirmative, 0 in the negative, the motion carries. Business under Article 31, Mr. Safina.
Okay. So Article 31 amendments are changes to Section 8.0 regarding signs. So some of you may be aware that in 2015, the Supreme Court ruled in this Reed decision that it's unconstitutional to read a sign to determine where it can go or what size it can be, basically. And so our signage bylaw was determined to be unconstitutional, as were, I guess, all the signage bylaws across the country. And that's why we're making these changes here. We are rewording, we've recodified the entire section to come into compliance with the Supreme Court decision.
Do we have a CPDC report?
Do we want to do that before?
Oh, are you still? Yeah, I'm sorry. Continue.
All right, so the goal of this was to bring it into compliance with the Supreme Court ruling. We can still regulate signs in terms of size, number, location, materials, but not for content. For example, previously we would have said a real estate sign, but now we would have to say, what? On a site that is for sale through a licensed real estate agent, etc. So bear with us as we go through this, because it was a fun task, I guess. We didn't make any substantial changes other than to bring this into compliance with that ruling. And to add some clarity, we made a few minor changes here where certain types of signs were defined and prohibited. That added some clarity, but there were other signs that were defined that were similar to this, just these weren't specifically called. Obscene matter is prohibited. We added an order to prohibit that. We added some clarity on what halo-lit signs are. And then we added language for temporary signs. Again, because we can't read the sign to tell you what to do with it, we had to add a lot of language that allowed for all of these signs that you may want to have. Flags for businesses are allowed during hours of operation. Again, formerly we would have said a business could have an open sign, but we can't say that anymore. You can't look at the flag. We just tell you you can have one. And then we added some language to allow some text on awnings. Again, we don't tell you what text to have on there, but we can tell you that if it's, you know, 4 inches by 36, inches that it's allowed. Some other changes we made, we added some graphics to help with the definition, and then we reorganized it to try and make it more user-friendly and simpler, and then we moved the table to the end. In the future, we'll start making changes about some substantive changes that could help businesses or keep our signage in order. But for now, what we were concerned with was coming into compliance with the Supreme Court ruling.
Okay, CPDC report.
On Monday, August 8th, 2016, the CPDC convened to hold a public hearing on the proposed Article 31. All documents were made available on the town website. Public hearing was held to provide an opportunity for comment and to determine whether the provisions of the proposed zoning bylaw shall be adopted by the town. The August 8th, 2016 public hearing was opened at approximately 7:30 p.m. Any comments received at the hearing were included as part of the public hearing, as a record of the hearing. Public hearing was continued to Monday, August 22nd, 2016 at 9 p.m. to allow time for further discussion and public input. On August 22nd, 2016, the hearing was closed. The CPDC voted 4-0-0 to recommend Article 31 to town meeting.
Further discussion? Yes, Ms. Young.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Megan Young, Precinct 4. I'd submitted two possible amendments. I hadn't talked to Mr. Savina, so hopefully you have those available. So the first, and I can take them independently.
We'll take them independently. Yes. We'll take the first one first.
Okay, yeah. So the first, and I attended the August meeting and actually met with Julie afterwards, and I was really pleased with the way the direction. It took me a while to get my head around the new way that we say things, but now I understand. And I believe, Nick, that the thing that I'm talking about, signs, this is a new definition. We didn't have this before. Is that correct?
I think we cleaned it up.
I didn't see it in the definitions. But anyway, one of the things I said to Julie is that I thought that most of the definitions that we had are really clean, but that the sign definition, one that I think is very important, needed to be cleaned up a little bit. And then, so what I'm suggesting is I was actually gonna stop at the end of business, but then after talking to Mr. Safina, I think it was including the supporting structure of where attached directly to building wall or surface. You said that that's places where CPDC had trouble before in defining a sign. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct. The building inspector in the past had trouble with that.
Thank you. So I'd like to end the definition at surface. If you look at what I struck out, the above that in red where it said sign area, that definition is directly below sign. And I didn't know that that phrase gave any help to the definition. And then the other things that I struck out were along the lines of what looked to be rules to me. The outline enclosing, signs located completely within an enclosed building and not exposed to view from a street shall not be considered a sign for the purpose of the bylaw herein. And in definitions, I really hadn't seen any other place where you actually gave a rule or something like, to me, this is either an enclosed, that it should be either in allowed or it should maybe be in notes. But I don't know that a general business would be able to find that guidance by looking, in a definition versus somewhere where you can actually see it in maybe the table or something. So anyway, I took that one out, that to me would leave a much cleaner definition of sign.
Is there a second to that proposed amendment? Second. Further discussion?
I think if you look at...
Mrs. Safina.
If you look at the warrant, the way it's written, so what Megan was, Ms. Young was saying was that this full definition here, which she's edited up here, contains language that is in sign area as well, and so she was proposing to remove it from the definition of sign since it's already contained in this definition sign area below.
Okay. Further discussion on that proposed amendment? Not appearing. All those in favor of the proposed amendment? Yes, we have a... Oh, who? While we're discussing this, we'll vote on this amendment, and then we'll be open to other amendments. Okay, further discussion on this? Not appearing. All those in favor of the... Is that discussion? Okay.
April Northrup, Precinct 6. I understand why we would strike through the first part and where sign area means the space enclosed within the extreme edges of the sign for each face. I'm wondering about the second part, and I'm not sure if it's explained somewhere else, but the part where it says signs located completely within enclosed building and not exposed to view shall not be considered a sign for the purposes of the bylaw herein. I thought that language was helpful so that it's clear that we're not attempting to regulate any signs that a business or institution might put inside their building.
That's correct. I think the intent is to move that language to another piece, to another section here, where it makes more sense.
Where would the other section be?
According to Ms. Young's writing here, she would suggest putting it in the table, but I thought we had discussed putting it in a different paragraph.
I'm not sure. I would maybe just offer a friendly amendment to not strike through that sentence. Signs located completely within an enclosed building and not exposed to view from a street shall not be considered a sign for the purposes of the bylaw herein. I'm just looking because it says, the first sentence does say a sign is something that is painted or represented directly or indirectly upon a building or another outdoor surface. I just liked that sentence of making it very explicit that if it's something within your business or institution, it's not regulated. Thank you.
Further discussion? And appear, Ms. Young.
Just want to remember where you had mentioned putting it previously.
Megan Young, Precinct 4. I, too, love that sentence, but I'm recommending it either be in allowed or in the table notes number 2, where it can be seen or and immediately, because I think it's a very good point, and it should be either, I don't know if allowed works, but I definitely think it could work in notes in the table.
Do you want to make that as part of that all one encompassing?
I mean, I didn't know whether I could
well,
if
it's
we
a
were
little,
talking about the definition, so.
But you wanted to, rather than just strike it, you actually wanted to move it somewhere else.
To move
else.
It, yes.
I would allow that as part of that amendment. If you,
all right,
but pick
thank
a,
you.
But you have to pick a spot.
So that sentence, without the whole bylaw herein, it would just be signs located completely within enclosed building and not exposed to view from a street shall be considered a sign. To move that to the table, and I think it's number 2. I think there's number 1, and I would just make that number 2. In the table of signs, I don't know what number that is, what page that is, but... So I recommend moving it to the notes section, and I wouldn't mind that in, I mean, it, right now it would be under N.
Okay, so your motion is to make that
my
section
My motion is
N.
to move that sentence to the table under notes.
Under a new section N.
And add N to it.
Okay, fine. I will accept that as part of your motion. I didn't realize your two motions were so tied
Thank
together.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Yes. Mr. O'Sullivan.
Patrick O'Sullivan, Precinct 5. I am as much a fan of elegantly written bylaws as anyone else, but what we're doing here is sacrificing the integrity of the bylaw, changing what it covers, in a desire to have a cleaned up definition. If I open a restaurant two floors, a top floor and a basement, no windows in the basement. Then, and in that basement, I have on a whole wall a giant neon sign that says, Patrick's. Tasteless, yes. Is it a sign as people are referring to it? Yeah, absolutely. But this bylaw doesn't cover signs in common parlance. Signs are defined as outdoor signage, things that can be recognized from the street, signs in the door. It's not about, like, a decorative sign. And what you're doing is you're taking this law, or this bylaw on signage, and by exempting this and saying, we know you call these wall decorations not meant to be seen from outside signs, but they're not governed by this, you're saying this bylaw now covers this specific class of wall decorations. And I don't believe that's the intention, and I would not support this amendment. Thank you.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Mr. Mon.
Jamie Mon, Precinct 4. Maybe things have changed, but I was taught when you write a definition, you don't use the word you're defining. And in Ms. Young's proposed amendment, she's striking, in the area she's striking, we use the word sign 7 times. So I support taking that out.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment? Yes, Mr. Sylvester.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Paul Sylvester, Precinct 3. Just a question. How about putting this striked out section under 8.3, which covers authorized signs? Would this be appropriate as an authorized sign? It seems to have other similar kinds of things there.
Julie and I were just discussing that. 8.3 F would be a good place to put it. I'm afraid it might get lost at the back of that table.
Are you talking about that new section in? Is that what he means? What section are you talking about?
I would suggest putting it into 8.3, new paragraph F, with the same wording. I think that that's a better place. When someone's looking at what signs are authorized, they would realize that these are exempt from the bylaw. So we're not actually regulating them.
Mr. Silver,
if required, I would make that as a friendly amendment.
Well, I first asked Ms. Young, is that... That's okay with you. Is there any objection to that? None appearing. Okay, we will accept that as part of her amended proposed amendment. Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Mr. Daddario.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. On Daddario, Precinct 6. Just a quick question to the authors of the article. Do you feel that this amendment helps? Is that your take? I'd just like to know. Is that helping the amendment, helping your article?
The change to the definition helps. It simplifies it. It makes it a little clearer. And then maintaining this language that we're talking about now, I think, is important. Because we don't want to regulate those signs that are inside like that. We don't want them considered as signs.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment? Yes.
I have another answer to that.
Oh, okay. And then we'll get to you. We'll get the answer first.
John Weissman from CPDC. I'm not sure that I am completely in agreement with that. I think that moving that last statement from the notes where it says that's not a sign, a sign that's inside a building, to a sign that is not allowed, I guess I'm concerned that if we are then calling something that's inside the building a sign, and then maybe required to meet some of the bylaws, even if the sign is allowed, we're still then defining it as a sign. Maybe that doesn't matter. I'm looking at town council to sort of, because we have never viewed signs that were, something that you and I would call a sign that was inside the building, we've never We've never regulated those. So I'm concerned that we call them signs and call them allowed may end up with us regulating them when we have no intent to.
Okay.
As opposed to just putting it in a note saying a sign that's inside the building isn't a sign.
While he's looking that up, yes.
I think Jeffrey Carr in Precinct 7 had the same problem that Mr. Weston has, that we're saying this is an allowed sign because it's not a sign, that somehow there's something a little funny about moving that particular sentence to where we're now proposing to move it. If we want to put it into that section, it should say signs located completely within an enclosed buildings are allowed. Not that it's not a sign, but that it's allowed. Because it's a section about allowed signs, and now we're saying, oh, this isn't a sign, so is it allowed or is it not? Because it's not a sign, so it's not an allowed. Anyway.
Okay. Further discussion. Proposed amendment. Mr. Tuttle.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Dave Tuttle, Precinct 3. I hesitate to jump into this discussion. The issue is that a sign on the inside of a window on a building is a sign that we do regulate. It's entirely enclosed in the building, but because it is viewable from the exterior, it is something that we have chosen to and intend to regulate. So that the fact that the sign is inside the building cannot be the only discriminator. I'm not entirely sure how to word that. That's how we ended up with the awkward provisions that we have. We have regulations for window signage in terms of window coverage. We have regulations for illuminated signs hanging in the window, visible from the exterior. Perhaps we want to add a word to the definition of a sign to specify that it is on an exterior building surface or visible from the outside as part of the definition, and strike the entirely enclosed provision entirely.
Further discussion? Yes, Mr. Russell.
Jack Russell, Precinct 3. I have a question on temporary signs.
Right now we're discussing the proposed amendment.
Oh.
Yeah, I'll get back to you when we get back to the main motion. We have an answer over here, Mr. Meares.
Yeah. So the definition that was originally proposed includes the sentence, signs located completely within an enclosed building and not exposed to view from a street shall not be considered a sign for the purpose of the bylaw herein. So anything that's inside the building but it is visible from the street is still considered to be a sign. That's what the intended meaning is, and this sentence properly belongs in the definition and not in some substantive provision. Similarly, each display surface of a sign or signboard shall be considered to be a sign. That's just saying that if you've got a two-sided thing, each one is separately considered to be a sign. That belongs here. The other language that about the sign area, it seems fine to come out. So you're going to do a lot of pretzel logic if you take those two last sentences out. So my recommendation, I approve this language originally. I think these properly belong in the definition.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Ms. Binda.
Angela Binda, Precinct 5. With regards to what our counsel just said and the phrase exposed to view from a street, does intent about whether or not a sign is meant to be seen from outside have anything to do with it? And can you put in intended to be viewed from the street? So my question is, if you have like Walgreens and they plaster the glass walls, that's intended to be seen from the street. If you have a bar that on the very far wall has a sign, would you actually go in and say, you know what, that's inside your building, but because it's viewable, we are allowed to regulate that? And also, like, I know that there are places that just, I think on Two Haven Street, I could be wrong about this, they're glass fronts, and all of those directories, the doctor directories, those are often visible. So does intent on whether it is meant to be seen have anything to do with it? Like, would you actually, you know, regulate? As opposed to just being exposed to view from the street, intended to be seen from the street.
Mr. Savina.
It was always about advertising, I guess. It's not about, you know, vintage signs or decorations you might have in your restaurant back walls. We're just struggling with how to keep somebody from hanging a sign 1 foot off of their glass storefront and adding to the signage that they already had. That was the intent of this wording.
Right. So I think the intent, like, you know, that an interior sign could be exposed to view from a street, but it's not intended, that's not the purpose of it.
Yeah, this is existing.
Mr. Savina?
We're just checking to see if it's worded exactly that way. If it is, we don't intend to change that language because we're not making those kind of changes this go around.
While you're looking that up, is there further discussion on the proposed amendment? All right. You ready?
So, understand, today's exercise is not to fix the sign bylaw so that it is beautiful and coherent and simple to understand. Today's exercise is to make it constitutional. I believe the CPDC is interested in making further changes in a second round to address some of these peculiar situations, but the current zoning bylaw includes a provision that says that a sign cannot be placed within would require a permit to be placed within the premises closer than 5 feet from any window or door and situated or designed so that the sign's graphic content is visible from the outside through a window or door, and then provides a whole bunch of criteria. That is retained in the current, in the proposal, basically word for word in 8.5.1.D. I would not recommend that we task the building inspector with figuring out what somebody intends. It's going to be hard enough to enforce this provision as is. What's visible from the street is a bit of a judgment call. Anyway, when we come back to clean up the bylaw more thoroughly, I'm sure this will be a topic of great discussion. But today, we're just trying to make it understand where we are today. I have advised the building inspector essentially not to enforce the sign bylaw at all, and that if he feels as though he must, because he's got a demand to enforce, for example, that he should consult with me. But pretty much everything that we've got today creates different rules based on the content of the sign and therefore is not legally enforceable under the new Supreme Court ruling. This will allow the building inspector at least to begin enforcing things, but it doesn't address the other question, which is why do we have 16 pages worth of zoning bylaws governing signs? Can't we do it in somewhat simpler fashion? That's the next round of effort that the CPDC has committed to undertake. I would not suggest that intended is a good word. I think that the language correctly reflects where we are today and the wisdom of regulating signs that are inside a building is for the CPDC to take up at their next round.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment? Not appearing. All those in favor, please raise your hand.
Point of information, Mr. Moderator.
What was that? Do we have a point of order? Mr. Sasso?
John Sasso, Precinct 2. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I apologize. We've moved this a couple times. What are we actually voting on here? Are we voting on moving this to the table? Is it being moved to the definitions? I just want to make sure we know exactly what is in front of us, please. Thank you.
That is a good point. Where did we end up? We originally were going to put it in the table, but I believe we moved it to... let's check that out. I couldn't hear you. I'm sorry. What?
I'm sorry. I don't believe that this edit has been made directly into the warrant language. It's just on Ms. Young's.
So where are we moving it? What was the last?
Well, we have two amendments, correct? We have the amendment to delete strike language from the definition of sign, and then the second change was to place a portion of this into the table.
I accepted that as one motion. So is it into the table? Is that what we, okay, so it's being moved into the table.
No, I'm sorry, and then there was a friendly...
Right, so where is it now?
Place it into 8.3F.
8.3F, okay. Okay, and that is all one amendment. So we're taking it from one place and moving a piece of it to another. So we're taking that N out. Okay, are we now all set? Okay.
Before, I'm sorry, I just want to make sure I understand. You're moving it to F? Okay, thank you.
Okay, everyone all set on that? All those in favor of the amendment, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion does not carry. Mr. Russell, did you have a comment on the main motion? Mr. Russell?
Jack Russell, Precinct 3. Relative to 8.3E, Roman 7. This is the essentially political signs, temporary signs. I'd like to eliminate the put a period after election in the third line down, and eliminate there shall be no maximum number of temporary signs permitted. And replace it with, and I understand there's a freedom of speech aspect here with the number of signs, but I think it's clearer to say multiple signs, each no more than 6 square feet, are allowed. And that brings in the area limitation on the political signs, which I think may apply from 1E1 above, but E1 above also says that there's just one sign. So it's, I would like to have the space restriction included in 7 also.
Okay, so get that wording again. What are you adding to it?
Multiple signs, each no more than 6 square feet, are allowed.
Okay, and that's a new sentence? Okay, we would need a capital on multiple. Oh, is that part of the sentence? Is it adding to the sentence?
No, that just that.
So it's its own sentence.
It's a new sentence.
Yes, so multiple should be capitalized.
Multiple should be capitalized, right.
Okay, is there a second to that? Second. Mr. Russell, you all...
It's an incomplete sentence. It's not.
Multiple signs. Right, you're right. Multiple signs are to be? What is... It's not a complete sentence, Mr. Russell.
There may be multiple signs.
That's what it said. It said before there will be no maximum number of temporary signs permitted.
Yeah, it is a sentence. Yes.
It's what we eliminated.
Right.
But nowhere in that paragraph did it have the area restriction.
Okay. Is there a second to that? Second. Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Yes, Mr. Sasso.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. John Sasso, Precinct 2. Given that we're talking about this section here in particular, so how, I realize we're not trying to subject content, but so at this point you're saying multiple signs, but are you relating it to the subject matter of the election? Is there any context whatsoever to this? So someone can put Eat at Joe's in the front of their lawn during that, and it's not, okay. I just want to make sure we understand, because that's what we're basically saying here. We're allowing anything at all, plus or minus 60 days regarding an election. Okay.
That is the wisdom of the court decision.
All right, thank you.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Mr. Savina.
If we make that change, we also have to make a change to the table for municipal, state, or federal election sign, we'd have to add the 6 square feet to the currently not applicable number.
Mr. Russell, would you like to add that as part of your proposed amendment? Yes, okay, can we get that wording? All set? Okay. Further discussion on the proposed amendment? Yes, Ms. Young.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Megan Young, Precinct 4. That was actually the second motion I was going to make, too, was putting in that 6 feet. We had it in our prior bylaws and don't have it in this one, and I really do think it's important to have a dimension around the size of the signs. Thank you.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Mr. Daddario.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Ron Daddario, Precinct 6. Does this mean that the signs are limited to, we can have multiple signs on our lawn, but does it mean that they're limited to each to 6 square feet? Is that what this means? Okay, the only question I would ask on that is that something we want to do? I know I see occasionally somebody put a bigger sign up. I mean, do we want to control signs so that they can't be any larger than that? And I would just suggest, I mean, you know, how much do we want to control? I'm not in favor of huge signs, but, you know, how much do we want to control? I'm kind of not so much for it. If somebody wants to put a bigger sign up for a while, even though I'm probably not going to be in favor of the person they're trying to get elected, I mean, I don't know how much we want to limit. So I'm kind of thinking of perhaps not voting for this.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Mr. Tafoya.
Ben Tafoya, Precinct 4. Perhaps Mr. Safina was going to make this point. This is the similar to the restrictions that are currently in our sign bylaw on the dimensions of signs for that purpose. And as you can see, if you look at the table, you can see that there are other kinds of temporary signs that have the same kind of size restrictions imposed.
That's true. And because you're not limited to how many signs you can have, you can actually arrange them the way these seats are arranged and make one big giant sign up. So this impels you to be creative.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment? None appearing. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Now we're back to the main motion again. Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Bill Brown, Precinct 8. On page 45 of our handout on the government signs, I don't. It just says government signs. It talks banners and all that other sort of stuff. On the definitions, I guess it is. Yeah, I got it on page 45 of the handout, so that's what I'm going by. Yeah, I think, is that it? Yeah. Okay, I think you had it up there, Nick. Thank you, right there. The small four, a flag adopted by the federal government, how about replacing that with a federal government? Not the United States. Striking the word.
You want to change the to a?
Yes.
Okay.
And then the same with this, and instead of this, a state.
Okay. So change the to a, the a federal and a state.
Right.
Flag. Okay. Is there a second to that proposed amendment? Second? Mr. Brown?
The reason I say that, there is a coffee shop down at the depot. They display a Swiss flag, and I think that's appropriate. Maybe it's not, but I think that it's appropriate for them to have a other than the United States flag. And there are probably other businesses that would like to display it.
Okay, so that flag would not be considered to be a government sign. The definition of a government sign is that it's constructed, placed, or maintained by the federal, state, or local government. So only the government construct, place, or maintain a government sign. That's the first part of the definition. The second part of the definition says that it is required to be constructed, placed, or maintained by the federal, state, or town government in order to enforce property rights. So the flag of another country that's put up voluntarily is not intended to be included in this definition.
But is it allowed under the sign bylaws? Okay, thank you. Then I'll withdraw my motion. Okay, I'll withdraw it then.
Okay, further discussion on the main motion. Mr. Barnes?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jonathan Barnes, Precinct 5. I realize that the primary or the motivating purpose is to conform to the Constitution, constitutional requirements, and I I admire town councils and CPDCs and town government's patience and tenacity in tackling that topic. In looking at the existing sign bylaw and trying to be consistent with that requirement, I noticed in 8.1, which is sort of the purpose section, if you will, it was all stricken and replaced, and I'm not opposed to that, but I am concerned at striking certain aspects of it, which I would like to propose a small amendment to that section, because I think it's important as an exercise of CPDC and important to the character and identity of the town of Reading, which is a primary goal of the master plan. And I would also note that I'm aware of the tension for CPDC and for any board or town in assessing aesthetics, if you will. And I know that CPDC has to do this all the time with respect to site plan or subdivisions, and particularly with respect to signs. And I'm sensitive to the issue of not getting into content. However, I note, particularly with respect to the Business B, which is the downtown area, and I think also the area over by REI and Mandarin Reading. Am I correct that that's also Business B? So the pretty important sections of town where the requirement for a certificate of appropriateness issued by the CPDC still remains, correct? And in looking at that that section and the responsibility of CPDC, it's their responsibility in reviewing those signs for appropriateness in order to issue the certificate, and they consider the design, the arrangement, the location, the texture, the materials, et cetera, and other visual characteristics of the sign with regard to the purposes outlined in section 8.1, which is the section I was initially referring to where everything else got stricken and replaced. And I would simply like to add back in something that was taken out because I don't believe it's an element that is currently covered by the four factors currently contained, which go to efficient communication, avoiding conflict, encouraging compatibility. But nothing really addresses what was removed in the context of the following, which I'd like to propose in as an amendment, and add to that 8.1 at the very end, after uses, I'd make that a semicolon, and then I would add, and enhance and protect the physical appearance of the community, which was previously in the old 8.1, which has been stricken. And in doing that, I guess, Mr. Safina, I would also say that you should strike the end in number three, support economic vitality and opportunity, and have that just be a semicolon, and then go to four, and then at the end of four, add, and enhance and protect the physical appearance of the community. That way, CPDC, when it's assessing for a certificate of appropriateness in Business B, could at least include the character and identity of the town and the degree to which the particular sign enhances and protects the physical appearance of the community. Thank you.
Okay, is there a second to that motion? Second. Further discussion on the proposed amendment? None appearing. All those in favor, please raise your hand. And those opposed? Motion carries. Back to the main motion. Any further discussion? Yes, Ms. Whiting.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Carolyn Whiting, Precinct 7. On page 90, page 90 of the warrant, so it's section 8.3. It says, in addition to flags that are authorized under section 8.3 IV, I think it should be 8.3.A IV. Does that make sense?
Could you recite that section, please?
It's just before 8.4. That's probably the easiest way to find it. Right there.
Okay, what was the question?
Whether that reference to section 8.3 IV should really be 8.3.A IV?
Okay, they're saying yes.
Is she correct? Is that, okay. Are you accepting that as part of your motion?
That's great.
Just okay, make, and then I just want to make sure that that's what they're saying. Is that what you're saying, Mr. Safina?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Okay. Did you have another comment, Ms.
Yes,
Whiting?
I did. In section 8.4 I, I'm questioning whether that applies to bumper stickers and magnets that you might put on your car. Because I have a problem with that if I can't put bumper stickers, you know.
It's not intended to be that. It's those, well, we would normally say commercial message, but it's those moving vehicles that have big...
I mean, you know, if I want to put a sign on my car that says peace, is that, you know...
That's not the intent.
This language exists in the bylaw today, and to the greatest extent possible, we were trying to keep the changes merely to things that impacted the constitutionality of the bylaw.
Okay.
It's not our intent to try to regulate those anyways. We don't care
okay.
About
okay. Further discussion on the main motion? None appearing. We all set for the vote? All those in favor, please rise. Twenty-six. Mr. Crook?
23.
19.
19. Forty-one. And those opposed, please rise.
Zero.
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 Zero. Zero. The vote being 109 in the affirmative, 0 in the negative, the motion carries. Now, before we accept the motion to adjourn sine die, which I think is about to come, I do want to remind you that we do have a special meeting on Thursday, December 8th. Mr. Halsey? You have a motion, Mr. Halsey? We have a motion to adjourn sine die. Is all those in favor? Is there a second? Second, all those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? Motion carries. This town meeting stands adjourned. Sine die.